Welcome to the chapter on online algorithms in our course Algorithms 2. So, what are online algorithms? The situation we are facing in many practical applications is that we don't know the future. Or for other reasons, maybe because of fog, we can't see all the information that we would like to have to make a decision, right? And computers also have to make decisions. So we have to think about algorithms handling this situation. So formally, we can say information is revealed to the algorithm piece by piece, but the decisions have to be made before the next piece of information is received. And now we have to think about how can we say that such an algorithm makes good decisions. So in online algorithms, one approach is to say we compare the algorithm with an algorithm that knows everything. And we have an analogy here to approximation algorithms. In approximation algorithms, we are comparing to an algorithm with a lot of processing power. Now we are comparing to an algorithm with a lot of knowledge about the future in this case. And we get a similar formalism with competitive ratios rather than approximation ratios. So in this lecture, I will first look at a simple, rather intuitive example, the ski rental problem. And then I will focus on a problem that is more relevant within computer science, namely that of paging in a virtual memory system. Other examples I'm not covering here are, for example, routing in communication networks, scheduling machines in a factory where orders arrive over time, or maybe a web company placing advertisements. But let's first look at the formal framework for our algorithm analysis. As I said, we are comparing an online algorithm, let's call it ALG, with an optimal offline algorithm, OPT. And what we are doing here is a worst case performance measure. So similar to approximation algorithms. So the competitive ratio C ALG of algorithm ALG is the ratio between the performance of our online algorithm divided by the performance of the optimal offline algorithm, and we are maximizing over all sequences of inputs, sigma. So it's worst case relative performance. Here we already see an important difference to maybe approaches that would use, I don't know, machine learning or so, where you base decisions on sequences that were observed in the past and try to do things that worked well frequently. This might lead to quite different algorithms, right? So we are having a rather pessimistic worldview here, namely that what happens in the future might be completely different from what we have seen before. And that leads, on the one hand, to algorithms that are very robust to changes in the situation. But on the other hand, these competitive ratios are sometimes extremely conservative, as we will see. So in online algorithms, we are usually looking for an algorithm that minimizes this competitive ratio. So let's now look at a concrete example that is quite simple, the ski rental problem. So say renting skis for a day or so costs 50 euros, but buying them costs 300 euros. Now, say you do that for the first time. You just move to a place where you can go skiing at all or whatever, right? Now, you do not know in advance how often you will go skiing, so it's a difficult decision. Should you rent the skis or buy them? So, and what I will look at now is an online algorithm that will actually turn out to be optimal, which does something very simple. It buys skis on the sixth trip, So the first 5 times you rent, and then you buy these keys, and then you never have to pay again. So let's look at how good is this algorithm, and can we do better? So let's look for an upper bound. So in other words, what is the competitive ratio of the algorithm? So this is a very simple situation, because actually, if we know the future, the optimal strategy is very simple, right? Namely, the optimal algorithm will buy the keys immediately if it makes more than at least 6 trips, say. And it will always rent if it knows that there will be at most 5 trips, right? So let's see. We have this thing where we plan to buy the keys on the 6 trips. If we make 5 trips or less, we are optimal, because we rent always. We are doing the same thing as the optimal algorithm. It's 50 euros per trip, right? If you make 6 trips or more, we pay exactly 550 euros. 250 euros for renting 5 times, and then 300 euros for buying the keys. Well, for this case that we have at least 6 trips, the optimal algorithm pays 300 euros. So the worst case is if you make 6 trips or more, then the competitive ratio is 550 divided by 300. It's 11 over 6. So our algorithm is 11 over 6 competitive. So it never pays more than 11 over 6 times the optimal cost. So let's look at the lower bound. Can we do better? Is there a better online algorithm? Well, this is a relatively easy to analyze situation, because there's actually only one thing that we have to look at in such an algorithm, namely, when do we buy, right? And suppose we buy the keys earlier than our online algorithm, so at trip X, where X is less than or equal to 5. Then we pay 300 euros for buying plus 50 times X minus 1. Right? Whereas the optimal algorithm pays 50x. Assuming now a case that you go skiing at most 5 times. Okay? Then your cost is 300 plus 50 times x minus 1. You can also write it as 250 plus 50x. Divided by 50x. You can divide by 50 and get 5 over x plus 1. And for x less than or equal to 5, this is at least 1. So you have a competitive ratio of at least 2, which is worse than the 11 over 6 of your algorithm where you bought at the 6th trip. So now you suppose you buy keys later, say on trip y larger than or equal to 7. Now you pay 300 plus 50 times y minus 1, whereas opt buys immediately, right? So it pays 300. So the competitive ratio is, once more, we do the 50 out of here, 250 plus 50y divided over 300 is 5 plus y over 6. And since y is larger than or equal to 7, this is larger than or equal to 2. So once more, you have a worse competitive ratio than our algorithm that buys at the 6th trip. So we have proven buying the 6th time is the optimal algorithm. And I mean, I use very concrete values for renting and buying costs. But there's a general rule, and you can easily generalize the proofs here. The idea is that you do not pay the large costs buying the keys until you would have paid the same amount in small costs, namely renting. So in that case, it was 300 divided by 50 is 6. So basically, you divide the buying cost by the renting cost, and then you get the number of times you should rent before you buy. So now let's look at a maybe somewhat less trivial problem, paging. So we are looking at a common way to use fast memory as cache. So computers usually have a small amount of fast memory, the cache. And this can be used to store data that is often used. And very often one makes a simplifying assumption that this is done in fixed size pages. For example, current computers often have in the operating system 4 kilobyte large pages. And that's actually also an appropriate page size to access, for example, solid state disks. So now the algorithmic problem you have to face is if the cache is full and you request a new page, which page should be thrown out or evicted in order to make room for the new one? So this picture shows this situation. We have a sequence of page accesses, and the identity of the page I have color-coded here. And we have space for storing k pages in the cache. And there's a large memory. It's like in the external memory model, right? You can access one page in one step. And we don't know the sequence in advance for an online algorithm. I will look also at an offline algorithm where we know the sequence in advance, right? We are running through this predetermined sequence of accesses, but we don't know it in advance. So k is our variable for the size of the cache. And our cost model is very easy. We say a cache hit costs nothing since accessing the main memory or the fast memory is very fast. And a fault, namely if you have to fetch a page from the large memory, has a cost of 1. So this is in full accordance to the external memory model, actually. And the goal is to minimize the number of page faults for your sequence. And of course, for this online algorithm framework, we look at the worst case somehow, comparing to the optimal algorithm. So let's look at a couple of possible paging algorithms. So this table shows the name of the algorithm and the choice for which page to evict. The last in, first out, LIFO, evicts the newest page that has been read. That sounds not so useful, but this is already something that looks useful. First in, first out, where you evict the oldest page. Or what sounds reasonable is least frequently used. You throw out things that are not used very often. Then least recently used is actually what is very often used in practice. So that throws out the page that is has been requested. So the difference between LIU and FIFO is that when you access a page again, then it basically is moved forward in the your list of in what order to throw out things. And there's something that looks strange, but actually will show to be not so bad from a theoretical point of view: flush when full. So whenever the cache is full, throw away everything. And then page new things, right? And then there's an offline algorithm where we will show that it's actually optimal. It's longest forward distance. Here, it's kind of a symmetric thing to least recently used, but using information not from the past, but from the future. Namely, it throws out the page that is reused the latest in the future. So suppose I'm in the sequence sigma at this point, and time moves in this direction. I want to access the green page, but the cache contains the red, blue, and yellow pages. And if you can look into the future, we see, the one that I don't need for the longest time is the yellow one here. So I throw out the yellow one. And we will show that this is an optimal offline strategy. So what we want to show is any optimal offline algorithm can be changed to act like the longest forward distance algorithm without increasing the number of page faults. So we will do an inductive proof that works a little bit differently to other inductive proofs that you may have seen, but it's not really surprising. The difficulty here is, there could be lots of optimal algorithms with very complicated decision rules. How do we show that it is no better than one very specific algorithm? Well, we go about it step by step. And what I show you, what I look at now is a lemma that does a single step of this induction. So what we want to have is that given an algorithm, we can create an algorithm E with the following feature. ALG and ALG E act identically on the first I minus one requests. And if the I-th request causes a fault, then note that both algorithms will have a fault here because they behave identically before step I, right? So in particular, they also have the same cache content. ALG may do anything, but ALG E will evict the page with the longest forward distance. So the picture shows what's happening. So ALG does something, right? And in this prefix of the first I minus one steps, ALG E does the same thing. And then in the E step, ALG E follows the longest forward distance strategy. So assuming we have shown this claim, we can now show the thing we actually want to do by actually performing this induction now. We first use the claim for I equals one, making sure that ALG one does the same thing as the optimal algorithm in the first step. And then you apply the claim for I equals two to ALG one. So this proof of the claim makes maybe complicated things with the remaining part of the algorithms. But that doesn't concern us here because ALG1 is an optimal algorithm that uses LFD in the first step. And then we can forget about opt. We just use ALG1 and apply the claim with I equals 2 to ALG1. Then we can make sure that afterwards ALG2 behaves like LFD in the first two steps and so on. So the final algorithm is still optimal and it's exactly the LFD algorithm. So now I should prove the claim, but I'm actually chickening out. It's not a really difficult proof, but to do it correctly is quite technical, and I actually don't like to do that in a lecture. But I can give you a basic draft. So what we have is there's this algorithm, we have ALG I that behaves the way we want. And we change a single step in the algorithm, meaning we are changing the state of the cache, right? And now you have to look at the behavior of ALG. It will make certain decisions, and we basically have to change the decisions in an appropriate way to take care of the fact that we have a slightly different cache content here. And the point will actually be that if you do this LFD, longest forward distance decision, actually you can swap some decisions out that will always work out because this stuff you have thrown out will be reused fine to the future, so you have no problem then. And actually when you have reached that point when it will be accessed again, then the two algorithms become identical again. So let's now look at a couple of these paging algorithms that I have introduced. So we have this optimal algorithm. It's not an online algorithm since it looks forward. So what is the best one of the online algorithms? So not surprisingly, LIFO is not competitive. So consider an input sequence, page 1, page 2, page k minus 1, page k. So then the cache is full. Now we access a page pk plus 1. Which means something has been thrown out, right? And LIFO throws out PK. Then, okay, then let's say PK is the next page we access. Then LIFO throws out PK plus 1. So we simply say, well, then we access PK plus 1 the next time, which is a page fault. LIFO throws out page PK, so then I access PK again. So we have a very stupid situation. For almost more or less infinite time, we are accessing just two pages. And although we have a cache capacity of K, we always have page faults. So obviously LIFO is one of the worst strategies you can think of. And actually such sequences also happen in practice, right? You very often has high temporal locality, meaning that something that you have accessed will be accessed frequently again in the near future. And the competitive ratio will be unbounded because the optimal algorithm will basically have page faults here, and then it will never have page faults because it just needs to store these pages. So opt has something like k accesses. Your algorithm has n accesses for a sequence of n, and if you go n to infinity, then n over k goes to infinity, right? So the competitive ratio is unbounded, infinite. So let's look at the least frequently used, which actually seems to be a good algorithm from some intuitive point of view. I mean, it should be a good idea to access frequently accessed pages, right? But actually, it's not true. Consider the following sequence. We are accessing page 1, a parameter m times. And consider m will be a very large number. Then we access page 2 m times, page k minus 1 m times. So both the optimum algorithm and least frequently used will have incurred k minus 1 page fault up to that point. And now we are accessing pk and then pk plus 1, and we repeat that m minus 1 times. So during all that time, pages p1 through pk minus 1 have been accessed more frequently than pk and pk plus 1. So we will have the same situation, at least for m minus 1 steps, as we have in the LIFO algorithm, namely, that I keep throwing out the least recently accessed page, although I need it next. Then the number of page faults for the optimal algorithm, the optimal algorithm will have k plus 1 page faults, right? And then never again, because it knows that this is happening. So you have k plus 1 page faults. Whereas our algorithm has k minus 1 page faults up to here. And then 2 times m minus 1 page faults here. And now if you let m grow to a much larger value than k, then the competitive ratio will also go to infinity, meaning that least frequently used is not a competitive algorithm. Now, before we look at the question what are actually good or in some sense optimal online paging algorithms, let's see how good we can get anyway. Recall that this is a very conservative bound, and not knowing the future has a really high cost. In particular, we will see that this is true for paging. And now I will give you a typical example of what happens when you show lower bounds for online algorithms. Namely, you look for an adversary that really wants you bad, right? It knows exactly what you are doing. It knows your algorithm, and it reacts on it in a maximally malicious way. And for paging, this means the following thing. So we can look at the seemingly easy situation where we have a sequence of page accesses that access just k plus one pages. Recall, if you have only k different pages, then after an initial warm-up phase, there will be no more page faults. So that seems to be like the most simple situation you can think of, right? Just make the right decision about keeping the right pages, but there's only one wrong decision each time, right? Yeah, but on the other hand, the adversary knows your algorithm, right? So it knows which k pages the algorithm has in its cache in each step. So since there are k plus one different pages, there's always one page missing. And then the adversary simply says, oh yeah, that's the next page I want. Then your algorithm will have a cache miss. And it will make some decision. Maybe it's a very clever decision, but the adversary knows this decision, right? And it voids the usefulness of any decision by doing something in the future that you have not anticipated. It will force you to have a page fault in every step. On the other hand, we can show that the optimal algorithm has a fault only once every k steps. With this input sequence. I'll not tell you why at this point. Please think about it, and we'll discuss it in the flipped classroom session. So then your competitive ratio is something like a page fault in every step divided by a page fault every k steps. So the competitive ratio will be at least k. So this is really bad news, right? You always thought having a large cache is good. Well, not for an online algorithm, because the larger your cache, the worse things get. This may be counterintuitive, and we will later see that with a slightly different view on the things, we can make things right again. But I think it's anyway important to understand this. So the more complex the situation, I mean, maybe that's the right interpretation, the more complex the situation, in this case, the larger the cache, the more freedom you have, the more things can go really wrong. That's what you see by this disheartening result. On the other hand, well, then let the competitive ratio be k. We can still ask, okay, what paging algorithms can achieve this competitive ratio? And that's what we'll do. So I will now do both. I will actually analyze an entire family of algorithms, of online algorithms, show that they have competitive ratio k. But I will immediately generalize by saying, I also consider the case where the offline algorithm has less cache than the online algorithm. That's what's called resource augmentation. So let the offline cache be size h. It says less than k, but it can also be less than or equal to k. So we also have our standard online situation. And then we call this hk paging. So now I will look at an entire family of algorithms, namely conservative algorithm. And an algorithm is conservative if it has at most k page faults on any request sequence or subsequence that contains at most k distinct pages. It looks like a fairly technical criterion, but it actually makes sense. And we can show that least recently used and also FIFO have this property. It's also not so difficult to see that least frequently used and LIFO are not conservative. Yeah, so I don't want to go into the details of the proofs that these two algorithms are conservative, but maybe look at an interval in time. So, for example, at k equals 3, and look in this sequence at any subsequence of accesses that access only at most 3 different pages, as you have here. I mean, regardless what is the content of the cache at this time, within this sequence, when a page is loaded, it will get precedence over all the pages that have been there before. Both in FIFO and least recently used, right? So they will kept inside the cache during this entire subsequence, and you thus have the worst case situation is that none of this has been in the cache before, and then you have exactly k cache faults and maybe less. Okay, so now we will show that any conservative algorithm is k over k minus h plus 1 competitive. In particular, if k equals h, we will have shown k competitiveness. The proof works like this. We are dividing the request sequence sigma into phases. Therefore, some orthogonality, phase 0 is an empty sequence, and then the subsequent phases are maximally long subsequences following phase, the previous phase, I minus 1, that contains at most k distinct pages. So in other words, we go through sigma and cut it into pieces that request exactly k distinct pages. So, for example, this sequence sigma has 3 phases at k equals 3. The first phase, red, blue, yellow, and then comes green, which would be a fourth. So we have to start a new phase. And then we have green, red, blue. And we stick to this green, blue, red, blue. We all have that present, but then comes yellow, which forces us to start the next phase, and then it's yellow, red, green up to the end. So overall, we have 3 phases. And note that this partitioning does not depend on the algorithm, which will be important for the analysis. And any conservative algorithm will have at most k faults per phase. So any conservative algorithm will have at most 9 faults on this particular sequence, for example. Now let's at first estimate the faults incurred by the optimal algorithm. So consider some phase I larger than 0, and let the first request be f. So this picture shows this. This solid rectangle is the phase. It's starts by an access to page F. So then at this point here, we have page F in the cache and H minus 1 other pages. Moreover, we know that there are k distinct pages accessed within the phase. And then there's a k plus 1s that starts the next phase, right? So in particular, even excluding this thing here, there are k distinct page requests in the phase minus its first access plus the next access that defines the next phase, right? So these are k distinct pages. And actually, this are k plus 1 distinct pages, right? So f is not included in this calculation, which means that among these k distinct pages, I can only go back to the h minus, up to h minus 1 pages that may be in the cache, right? So within this gray thing, I have at least k minus the h minus 1 that might already be present. I have at least k minus h plus 1 false on these gray requests. Okay, so what we have is that the conservative algorithms need k false per phase by construction. And we have shown that an optimal algorithm needs at least k minus h plus 1 false in each phase. This is not quite true for the last phase because we have this overlap here. But for an online algorithm analysis, we can ignore that because for long sequences, this difference disappears. And in the supremum, it's just this ratio. K over k minus h plus 1 will become the competitive ratio. And yeah, in particular, if k equals h, we have a k competitive algorithm. But somehow the interesting case is if h is, say, half of k, then this is something like 1/2. And that sounds like a reasonable competitive ratio, right? We are losing something in, we need more cache, and we need more cache faults than an optimal algorithm, but it's just a factor of 2 in both respects. And that sounds like something, a reasonable price to pay for the lack of knowledge of the future. Okay. So there are also practical papers on paging algorithms, however, of course. And what they show is that actually LIU, even using the same size of the cache, has a competitive ratio actually quite close to one, small constant. But what we have learned is that resource augmentation is an important ingredient to get better results for competitive analysis and more realistic insights into the problem. So this problem that the pure competitive analysis thing gives you very conservative bounds has led to a significant amount of subsequent work. For example, one can think about what are natural input sequences and restrict the adversary to those. For example, one can look into locality of reference. So one requires that the sequences mostly access recently used pages. And one can look at other typical memory access patterns. So what people have observed, for example, that either you have these recently used stuff, or it's a long distance. And then for those, actually, it doesn't matter what happens with them, because even the optimal algorithm would evict them. And using that, you can then get more realistic bounds that are also theoretically sound. So another approach to somehow beat this evil adversary that leads to these bad competitive ratios is to look for randomized online algorithms. They can randomize their decisions, and that way we can actually get, in expectation, smaller ratios between the performance of the online algorithm and an optimal offline algorithm. So for paging, that means we have some randomness in the decision what to evict. And then, well, theorists have looked at that intensively, and then it depends on what the adversary knows about the random bits chosen by the algorithm. And there are three categories. The oblivious adversary, and that's, I think, the most interesting one. It's also the weakest adversary. So here, the adversary knows the random number generator you use, but not its seed somehow. It knows what probability distributions you are using, but not what the actual random numbers are. In particular, it depends the input before the algorithm runs and before it sets its seed and before it starts generating probabilistic decisions. And that's usually the, well, it's the weakest adversary, and then it's also much easier to analyze. So that's what I view as the most important model. A different thing is that maybe the adversary can observe what you are doing and infer from that what the random bits are that you choose in the past, and then it can adapt to the, your past random choices. And then there's this adaptive offline algorithm that the adversary knows all your random choices. And that usually doesn't, then usually randomness doesn't help, but there, apparently there are even cases where this is helpful. Yeah, so we focus on the oblivious adversary. So for the analysis once more, we will look at an entire family of algorithms. This time they're called marking algorithms. So marking algorithms mark pages which are requested. They never evict a marked page. But then, of course, you can't do that forever, right? So at some point, there will be no more unmarked pages that can be evicted. So if in that point there's a fault, you unmark everything, except that you mark the page which caused the fault. And that naturally defines a phase once more. So let's look at some marking algorithms. We have already seen LRU, and you can convince yourself that this is actually a marking algorithm. An extreme thing is flush when full. So whenever the cache is full and we look for a new page, we actually throw away everything. And a randomized marking algorithm that will be of particular interest now. We evict an unmarked page chosen uniformly at random. And we will now show that the randomized marking algorithm is 2HK competitive. So HK is a kth harmonic number. This is 1 plus 1 over 2 plus 1 over 3 plus and so on, 1 over K. And this is close to LNK, actually it's less than or equal to LNK plus 1. So 2 times HK is something like 2 LNK, which is much better than K for large K, right? So we go from a competitive ratio linear in K to something logarithmic in the cache size K. Yes, and what does it mean that a randomized algorithm has a certain competitive ratio? Then we look at the expectation of the competitive ratio, because the actual competitive ratio for concrete execution depends on the random choices, of course. So let's analyze the expected number of cache faults incurred by the randomized marking algorithm during a phase. So it turns out we have to look at a parameter m, that is the number of new pages that come in this phase. And that implies that during this phase there are k minus m old pages that are accessed. Now, what happens during this phase? Okay, at some point we will access the m new pages and they will cause faults, of course. Also, a new page will throw out old pages, right? They are, so there are these k minus m old pages that are in the cache. They are all unmarked at the beginning of the phase, and so they will be thrown out more or less randomly. Whenever a new page is accessed. So somehow the worst case is that all the m new page successes come first, because then I immediately throw out some stuff, right? And for that worst case, we are now compute the probability that we get a fault when an old page is accessed for the first time within this round. And then, of course, it is marked again, right? So I have already accessed J Yaza old pages, and now there's a J plus first. So in the hit probability is a ratio between the those unmarked old pages that are still in the cache divided by the total number of unmarked pages. And the miss probability is 1 minus this probability. So I have already marked J old pages, so there are K minus J old pages left for this phase. And in the worst case, up to M of them might already have been evicted because I fetched new pages. So this probability is K minus M minus J, that's the number of old unmarked cached pages in the worst case, divided by K minus J, the overall number of old unmarked pages. And the miss probability is 1 minus this ratio, and I can estimate the number of old unmarked cached pages by K minus M minus J, and the number of old unmarked pages by K minus J. And I can simplify this expression to M divided by K minus J. So now the kind of the difficult part, the probabilistic reasoning, combinatorics, and so is done, and I can start calculating. So what is the overall expected number of faults, including the new pages? That's M faults for the new pages. And I'm summing this expression from J equals 0 to K minus M minus 1. Because overall, I'm accessing K minus M old pages. So I can pull out the M here, then I have M plus M times, and the sum 1 over K minus J. So all these expressions will be 1 over an integer. Which integers show up here? And by a substitution of variables, I can actually see that the integers from m plus 1 through k show up in the divisor here. So I can also say, oh, I make a substitution that says instead of summing j from 0 to k minus m minus 1, I'm summing I from m plus 1 through k, 1 over I. And then the nice thing is this sum here is somehow a part of the harmonic series, and I can express it as a difference between two numbers in the harmonic series. So here it's m is moved out, and it's m times 1 plus, and this is like hk minus hm. And then this is smaller, this is less than or equal m times hk. So now let's look at the number of faults produced by an optimal algorithm, a lower bound on it. So let's have a look at two consecutive phases, I minus 1 and A. So this is phase I minus 1, this is phase I. So in phase I minus 1, the optimal algorithm looks at k distinct pages, and let mi be the number of new pages it looks at in phase I. Now the point is, overall these are k in phase I minus 1 and phase I, I'm accessing k plus mi distinct pages. And since the cache has size only k, even an optimal algorithm has to incur mi page faults in these two phases together. Thus, summing over all phases, the total number of page faults is at least 1/2 sum of the mi. So we can now compute the expected competitive ratio. So in phase I, the randomized marking algorithm incurs at most mihk faults. Summing over all phases is hk times sum i mi. Whereas the optimum algorithm has at least one half sum I m I false. If I compute the ratio, then this sum cancels out and we get 2HK competitiveness. So as I said, that's already much better than the K competitiveness of deterministic algorithms. And actually, it's also almost as good as I can get a randomized algorithm, because there's also lower bounds that show that no randomized algorithm can be better than HK competitive against an oblivious adversary. But I won't prove that here. So yeah, and in that sense, a randomized marking algorithm is an optimal randomized paging algorithm apart from a factor of two, at least in this framework of expected competitive ratio. There is actually a more complicated algorithm that actually achieves this lower bound and is HK competitive. So let's take a higher level view now. I have explained to you what online algorithms are. I gave a simple motivating example with the ski rental problem. And then I looked at a quite serious example, the paging problem, where we looked at competitive analysis in the worst case, with and without resource augmentation, with and without randomization. But now let's take a very high-level view. Why should we do competitive analysis? As I said, there are many other approaches to handling uncertainty, in particular, recently probabilistic approaches that may or may not be called machine learning become more and more important. But somehow, these models make sense if you have a good probabilistic model. But you need a lot of data on previous things, but maybe you don't know the future because it may be very different from what you think it is. So for example, in January 2020, probably few people in Germany would have predicted that 2020 would look the way it looked last year, right? So if we want to have very robust algorithms, then maybe a very pessimistic view like competitive analysis helps us to be robust. Also, even if you have a lot of data, to model it accurately as a probability distribution and so on is very complicated and makes many strange assumptions. And it's often also unrealistic. Yeah, and then there are some applications where you, for legal reasons, for example, you cannot do something like, yeah, probably you will not die when you drive our car or so, right? So you need to really guarantee it. For example, in financial planning, you sometimes have to give such guarantees. And then competitive analysis is really the method of choice. But there are, of course, also big disadvantages that we in part already discussed. So let's summarize that in more detail. So the results can be too pessimistic, basically because this adversary is maybe too powerful. You can hedge that a little bit by looking at resource augmentation, randomizations, or restrictions on the inputs. But still, it's a problem. From an algorithmic point of view, it's also strange that sometimes competitive analysis cannot distinguish between algorithms that perform quite differently in practice. For example, in practice, least recently used is much better than FIFO. But in our competitive analysis, they were both conservative algorithms that perform equally well. So here one probably wants to look at more refined models also. So thank you very much. That brings me to the end of the chapter on online algorithms. Bye-bye.